deal.
Wow.
Right.
This is what I believe, this is why I was taught. And my main question in that same line is that, why are we still dying? Why do we die? Why do we get old? Can you answer that question?
Have you an explanation? You see, now you must have an explanation yourself. Why are we dying? This body is not made to last forever. That's how it is. Everything that is on earth, everything that lives, must die. Everything. Unless there's something that says, look, the lions live forever. Or the donkeys live forever. That might be something. It says this. Everything that breathes must perish. So that's the law of nature. This body can't last for eternity.
Was the body intended to last forever?
No. If it was, then it would last forever.
Okay, then that's my question right there. Isn't it the reason why we die now is because of the first sin?
Right. So now, everything that God made, why do the animals die? What sin? Why do animals die? What sins did they commit?
No.
Then why should they die? If you're going to die for your sins, to be logical, everything must die for some crimes, some sin. For what crimes and sins do animals die? For the sin of Adam? Does it make sense to you? For the sin of Adam, every dog, pig and donkey dies. Every flea and fly dies because Adam sinned. Does it make sense to you? No. So this body, the human body that is born, is bound to perish. The Quran says, it says, every soul shall taste of death. Every soul shall taste of death, and everyone is destined to perish. And I'm sure you'll find verses in your Bible saying the same thing.
So that means that all of us will die as far as physical. But how about our souls or our spirits?
Right. The soul, the spirit, God tells you, when you disobey, you get punished. That is spiritual death. You disobey God, you spiritually you are dead. So physically you are alive. It says, the soul that sinneth, it shall die. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. Father Adam sinned. You, his children, are not responsible for Adam's sins. The son shall not bear the iniquity of the father. Neither shall the father bear the iniquity of the son. God Almighty will not question Adam and say, look, man, your children, 25 million sodomites in America. Gays, you call them gays.
Sodomites,
yes. Says, 25 million sodomites, look, what have you produced? God will not question Adam. Nor will he question us about Adam. Neither shall the son bear the iniquity of the father. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him. Whatever good thing the good man does, he gets his fruits, his benefits. And the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. Whatever wrong things you do, you pay for it. The way to salvation is given there in the book of Ezekiel. But if the righteous shall turn from all the sins that he has committed and do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. He shall not die. But we still die. So no, that death there is speaking about spiritual death. See? We all die, we perish, but no, spiritually he will be saved. He will be alive spiritually with God. So now this idea of Christ dying for your sins. In the first place, you say you're not a Trinitarian. Right. In other words, Jesus is not God.
That's correct.
Right. Now, as a man, if he died as a man, one man can't carry the sins of the world. You see, the Trinitarian is more logical. He said, you see, he must die as a God. Because only God can pay the price for billions of souls.
That's correct.
No, he's more logical. Not necessarily that he's true, but he's more logical. You are illogical, saying that one man carries the sins of the whole of mankind. One man carries another man's sin burden, okay? You know, somebody is prepared to get hanged for you, and suppose there is a law that allows you to do that, that guy gets hanged. But you can't pay for, catch one German and pay for the 6 million Jews that is incinerated. Can anybody, any one human being, pay for the 6 million Jews, life of 6 million Jews? You can't. So one man can't carry the sins of the world. So in other words, he's not God. The Muslims say he's not God. This guy said he's God. So he says, no, he's not God. Show me in your book where he is God. This idea of the Holy Trinity. I think it's in your book there. First chapter of John chapter 5 verse 7. In your Bible.
How about in Genesis?
How
about in Genesis?
No, no. The clearest statement on the Trinity happens to be the first epistle of John, chapter 5, verse 7, where it says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one.
Yes.
That's the clearest statement.
Okay.
Other thing is, now you're going to try and hook or by crook, try and justify it. He said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and that we and us, now we're going to start debating about grammar, Hebrew grammar, Arabic grammar, and Islam. But the clearest statement on the Trinity happens to be, I think it's in your Bible.
Yes, it is.
In your Bible too?
Yes.
In your Bible as well?
I don't think so.
What Bible are you carrying?
I carry a Jehovah's Witness Bible.
Right. Okay. No, it's not there. It's not there. But now, you too, you carry that.
That's correct.
Yes.
But now, that is King James Version, I think.
Yes, it is.
Yours is also King James.
Oh, yes.
Now, we have here, produced in America, the Revised Standard Version of the Bible. Revised by who? By Muslims or Jews? By Christians. Who revised them? Tom, Dick and Harry? No, no, no. It claimed that 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they went and produced this book. 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, they produced that Bible. Right. This one here. And they threw this verse out as an interpolation, as a falsity. It's thrown out as a fabrication. Now look, we didn't do this wrong. The Quran says, 1400 years ago, it says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا ثَلَاثَةً. Don't say Trinity. إِنْتَهُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. This is stop it. It will be better for you. إِنَّمَا اللَّهُ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ. For your God is one God. He is not three in one. 1400 years ago, Muhammad is meant to tell the world. So look, Trinity is a falsity. Stop it. Don't talk about it. Now, the Christian world has thrown it out as a fabrication. That verse, the foundation of the Trinity. So now you have to find out why do they do things like this? Your own people. And they made $15 million net profit on this before they came out with the second one. This is 1952. 1971, by that time, they had made, again, certain changes in here. But it is interesting to note what this book, these 32 scholars of the highest eminence, backed by 50 cooperating denominations, what they have to say about the King James Version. If you give me opportunity, I can read to you what they say.
Please.
The testimony. Right. Purpose. I'm reading the purpose. It says, the King James Version has with good reason been termed the noblest monument of English prose. Noblest monument of English prose. Its revisers in 1881 expressed admiration for its simplicity, its dignity, its power, its happy turns of expression, the music of its cadences, and the felicities of its rhythm. Can you add anything to that? Can anybody add anything to that? If somebody said that about the Quran, I says, man, that's the highest tribute you can pay to a book. And they do. They do. But I'm telling the Christian, they said, now prepare for the shock. This is so. It says, in tribute, it says, it's the admiration expression, the music, and the spirit of Israel. It entered as no other book has into the making of the personal character and the public institutions of the English-speaking peoples. We owe to it an incalculable debt to that book.